Happy Saturday. Good to see you. Day 26. In regards to what we're going to do today, we're just going to continue sort of plowing through this like maximum intensity approach to Kumbhaka and try to build up as much CO2 as possible to create as much internal physiological change as possible. So that sort of dominoes into the mind, and in that we have a more powerful meditative experience. But because we're sort of making our way into, you know, a truly commendable commitment, you know, 26 days straight of anything is commendable, as small as that is in terms of our lifespan or a year. I think it's unique to cold turkey just commit to something like that without breaking, and so many of you have been so successful at it. But I've gotten a few questions and had a few conversations in regards to sort of like a plateau effect, and I just wanted to talk about that because it's a really nice opportunity to see how difficult it is to adopt a yogic mentality and really absorb their philosophies in relationship to like any given thing. And you know, when we discuss this, this core idea really is extendable or transferable into other dimensions of our lives. And so the first thing is, life is defined by entropy, right? Everything decays, whether it's a giant oak tree, whether it's a star, whether it's a relationship, whether it's a career, or whether it's our interest in a given yoga technique. As yogis, as meditators, there's a world of techniques that we investigate and then we sort of like, you know, move away from because essentially we get bored and we no longer see its sparkle. And so the idea is this: all things are divine, okay? And we at first were initially intrigued with this idea of Kumbhaka, this idea of breath retention, for whatever reasons, whatever personal reasons they might be. And then over the course of the relationship, you know, we're 26 days into this relationship, our sense of curiosity starts to diminish. We start to hit this plateau. But where does that boredom, where does that diminishing or that dulling actually manifest? It manifests in the mind, right? It manifests as a thought and a complicated nest of thoughts, more than that. But we only feel the emotion. And a nice way of sort of considering emotions is that they are the consequence. They are the ambassadors of a world of analysis, a world of memories, a world of concepts, a world of preferences, a world of fantasies. And all we sort of receive is at the tip of the spear is this emotional output. I like it or I don't like it, essentially. Very sort of binary. But that is a thought. And the whole point is, it is remarkable to stay committed to any given thing. And the more time you stay committed to any given thing, whether it is a breath technique over the long run, you know, I've been doing Kumbhaka, let's just say, every day for 50 years. You know, if that were a truth, that would be, you know, impressive. I've been in a relationship for 80 years. The pyramids of Giza have been standing for, I don't know, 3,000, 2,000 years. So the longer something can survive the assault of time, the more empowering and inspiring it is. And so our technique, our relationship to it is no different. But the mind, again, compels us to look away from it. Yet we are compelled, we are designed to believe those impulses. And so as a yogi, as a meditator, what we're fundamentally trying to do is trust our instincts, trust what we want to give ourselves to, and then mistrust the mind that tells us to separate from it, especially in regards to our practice, in regards to these techniques. These techniques, more than, say, a relationship, more than, say, a job, which are more external to us, they're not proven as like divine or proven as necessarily good. So there's a lot of sort of room to move and interact with those external relationships. With the techniques that are time tested and sort of mythologically given to the masses through rishis, through seers, through really powerful human beings, these techniques in your practice is something to stay loyal to. And when the mind tells you to look away, it's like, oh, I see that it is my mind, you know, projecting propaganda, projecting weakness, projecting boredom, projecting, you know, false perception into me, compelling me to look away from something that will lead me into divinity. So that's a really interesting idea, and it's really cool to observe that sort of nuance within your practice. And in a lot of ways, that is the practice. Your commitment to it over time is the heart of it, and this is echoed through so many of the teachers. So I just want you to think of that. You can gain all this knowledge through the sutras, and so I'll just sort of iterate the second, third, and fourth sutra. The second sutra is yog chitta vritti nirodh, right? Unity with the divine, which is what we're attempting to do, is achieved through the cessation of thoughts. The thought that this technique that I know leads me to that place, and I as an individual am curious of that place for whatever reason, the way there is to suppress my thoughts, because eventually my thoughts will tell me to look away from that place, because that place is hard to get to, and it demands that I look at myself, and it demands I you know, unravel my imbalance and unravel my weakness, and not stay sort of too fixated on my strengths either. It's really this neutral mentality, which is unique. And then the second sutra is tadad rashtuha svarupe avashtanam. So, and then once you suppress your thought process, you achieve your true form. And that's what we're sort of going for, whether you know it or not. And that's sort of the bliss of that meditative state afterwards. It is true objective nature, where you're not thinking about yourself, you're not thinking about your future, and you're sort of relieved of the burden you place upon yourself. And then the fourth sutra is vritti sarupyam itaratra. When I am not in my true nature, I take the form of my thoughts. And when your thoughts are telling you to look away because they're bored, you become bored, and then you look away, and you don't practice, which is inevitable, but it's something to observe, and it's a chance to understand these philosophies. Cool. So, you know, food for thought. Let's get into our practice. So we're going to spend a little bit of time with Duke, with our suffering, and acknowledge all suffering is just due to misperception of a moment. And then we're going to get into right away max intensity and spend about 15 minutes in that intensity, collecting that CO2, and then coast off into just unguided quiet stillness and feeling. Just a little bit about that final part. That's your peak experience, and so it's so important at that point after the breath retention to not move anything, to sit with a really tall spine, let your breath breathe itself. The muscles have been stretched at that point, but the stillness is sort of paramount. It's really going to boost your experience, so take that to heart. Okay, let's do this. Day 26. Powerful seated pose, wrists resting on knees. Be mindful of your lines and your angles. Random finger to each thumb. Eyes are closed, jaw is shut. Press your tongue into the back of your two front teeth. Just start to slow down your breath. And so these time-tested techniques are the gurus. The techniques are the path to the experience you're looking for, which is the obliteration of self. And when our mind compels us to look away from this time-tested path, as if it knows more than this path that was devised by commendable people, and it's been carried through generations for thousands and thousands of years, when our little mind says something about that and we trust our mind, that is a misjudgment. And so honor imperfection, honor imbalance, honor insecurity, but then honor that it is also misperception. And in that moment of honesty, all of a sudden, everything is permitted. And so that moment of embrace strikes you quickly, like a flash of lightning. And that's all we need, one hit. And let's get into our technique. Maximum intensity. Inhale as slowly as you can. Feel the shakti, or that sense of invigoration and confidence physically and mentally that comes with the breath in. As you hold your breath, that boost in mental clarity. Work with your visualization. Let the body burn up. As you exhale, really appreciate the sense of tranquility and release. It's always there for you. Good work. I'll be practicing alongside you about 15 minutes in your technique today. Notice vrittis, notice thoughts. Push them to the side and just feel. And in that, appreciate that you can at least mentally step deeper into a physical experience that is already at its maximum. Don't analyze, don't interpret, just feel what's going on. Let the technique manage itself. With your next breath in, arms reach up and overhead, interlace your fingers, index fingers point up to the sky. Again, using that muscular contraction to help you hold your breath a little bit longer. And so everything stays relaxed until that critical moment. And then everything tightens. As you exhale, stay tall in the spine. And survive the intensity of that external retention. A few rounds here. One more full round. Inhale, exhale, hold. Then take one more breath in and hold your breath when your lungs are full one more time. At that point, when you must exhale, with dramatic grace, release your wrists to your knees, build your posture, and hold perfect, perfect stillness. Yog Chitta Vritti Nirodh. Yoga is the cessation of thoughts. We can restrain our thoughts by redirecting our attention into feeling. Slow down the breath slightly and feel those trails of subtle vibratory sensation. Again, think of blood flowing, nerves pulsing. Tadadrashtuha svarupe avashtanam. And then, once the mind is stilled, we achieve our true form. And that true form is an experience. It's a moment of embrace, a moment of presence, a moment of open mindfulness, accompanied with a sense of power, accompanied with a sense of peace. Slow down the breath again. Vritti sarupyam itaratra. At other times, we are our thoughts, our analysis, our inner voice, the fantasy of our future, the regrets of our past. Push out the world, slow down the breath. A few more minutes, purely feeling. Take three more breaths, a bit more slowly. Relax your muscles to induce a deeper sense of stillness. Do your best to push back the thought process and feel subtle sensations. Three more breaths. With dramatic grace, bring your hands to heart center, soften your face. And so our techniques support us in the process of meditating. And meditation as a process leads to meditation as an experience. That experience is something like a hidden pearl within the mind. At a certain point, it starts to glow. It becomes visible and perceivable, but still fairly out of reach. And as our capacity to meditate, to focus, and feel intensifies, we are able to bridge that gap. At a certain point, we learn to hold it or behold it, but only for brief moments. And if our practice continues, if we avoid the voice of boredom and of disinterest, which tells us to look away from these techniques, over time, we can hold it with greater and greater intimacy, building a relationship to this thing, meditation. So the point of that is, try to sense you're accessing something, an attitude, a state of mind, a condition, and that it feels right. Thumb knuckles to third eye center. And what is that illumined pearl? We still don't know. Certainly it's a state of physiology. Certainly it's a state of neurology. Certainly it's a state of psychology, but that doesn't really provide any answers. The yogi said it was Atman, it was soul. The only truly intangible thing in existence. And that intangible thing is the great counterbalance to a universe that is physical and expansive. With an exhale, release your wrists to your knees, random fingers to each thumb. Super deep thoughts, healthy thoughts, thoughts we can feel, which makes them even sweeter. And with a breath in, open your eyes and attempt to feel that relationship. Point A, deep inside the intangible something. And then point B, an expansive reality that is both familiar and utterly mysterious. And to be aware of all of it, it's a good space to be.